Hi everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon the time zone you are in. My name is Deepthi Goguri. First of all, I would like to thank Eric Mulder for giving me this wonderful opportunity to present for Drupal Jam Conference. This is my first time presenting for Drupal Jam Conference. It's really an honor. Thank you so much, Eric Mulder, for giving me this wonderful opportunity. Today, I'm going to present on the topic SQL Engine, its working style. So basically, this session is all about the internals and architecture of SQL Server, like what happens behind the scenes when a query is submitted to the SQL Server. So, and also, this session will also cover like how the relational engine as well as the relational databases, it might be any relational engine and databases like MySQL, MariaDB, OracleDB, they all follow the ACID properties of transactions. So we will also discuss that in the session today. So let's get started. A little bit about me. I'm a database administrator with 7 years of experience in managing SQL Server and databases. I'm a Microsoft certified trainer and Microsoft certified solution expert. I did my master's in computer technology at Eastern Illinois University, United States. I blog for dbanuggets.com. That's my website. And you can contact me on Twitter at dbanuggets. That's my user ID. And down below, that's my email address. If you have any questions regarding this session later, you can definitely contact me either on Twitter or through email. So what are we going to discuss in this session today? We are going to see the ACID properties of transaction with a simple example ensuring the ACID property. Basically, this applies to all the relational databases and relational engines. And also, we are going to see the different types of components we have in the memory architecture of SQL Server. In this session, we are mainly focusing on major components of the memory architecture of SQL Server, that's plan cache and the buffer pool, and how these cache get managed inside the SQL engine. And we are also going to see the lifecycle of a query for the read as well as the write transactions. Basically, what happens behind the scenes at each component inside the SQL engine when we submit a query, even from the management studio or from the application side. So, and also we are going to see the different types of components we have in the SQL engine, that's relational engine as well as the storage engine. So internals, why should we actually care? Many DBAs and developers, they work with SQL Server and relational databases every day, but they might not understand what happens behind the scenes when we submit any query. So knowing this information will help you in understanding how queries are processed at each stage inside the SQL engine. It will also help you in tracking down the performance issues very quickly and fix them efficiently. It will also build your confidence while managing the database engine as well as the databases. It will also help you in convincing your managers or coworkers of why they have to take your ideas seriously. Last but not least, we all work with relational engine and relational databases every day. So the more we know about the internals, the better we can understand how these relational engines and databases work. So let's start with basics, right? The ACID properties. Every major relational engine, it can be SQL Server, Oracle, MySQL, MariaDB, Sybase, all these major relational engines should satisfy the ACID properties of transactions. So what is this ACID? A stands for atomicity. Atomic meaning a single unit of work. A single transaction can contain one operation or it can contain multiple operations. So whenever a transaction is executed onto the relational engine, it should either succeed completely or none of them should be completed successfully. For example, we have a store procedure, and that store procedure have two operations in it inside a single transaction, inside the store procedure, an update statement as well as an insert statement in it. Whenever you execute that store procedure, both the operations inside that single transaction should either completely successful or none of them. For example, if the update succeeds and if the insert fails, then the SQL engine or the relational engine should roll back the entire transaction completely. That's atomicity. C stands for consistency. All the data inside the database should always be consistent before starting the transaction and after completing the transaction. For example, if I am doing an update statement onto the table and in between my update, if something happens suddenly, like if the SQL engine went down and if we had to restart the server, then once we restart the server, all the uncommitted transactions should be completely rolled back, making the data in the consistent state. That's consistency. I stands for isolation. No matter how many concurrent transactions are happening at the same time, each and every transaction should be independent of each other and should not interfere with any other transaction. For example, if I'm inserting few rows into a table, and while I'm doing that insert, none of the other transactions should be interfering with my transaction. That's isolation. D stands for durability. So once the transaction is successfully completed and all the data has been already made to the database, should be permanent. For example, if I had to restart the SQL server later or any relational engine later, then once I restart the server, then all the data that has been already committed to the database should be permanent without any data loss. That's durability. So what components of this SQL engine will ensure this ACID properties of transaction? Atomicity is very easy to be ensured. It is taken care by the parse component inside the relational engine. Consistency is also very easy to be ensured. It is taken care by the parser as well as the binder components inside the relational engine. Isolation is all about the locking mechanism. It is taken care by the lock manager inside the storage engine. Durability is the most toughest of all. It is taken care by the transaction log inside the storage engine. So once the atomicity, isolation, and durability are ensured, consistency will automatically be ensured. Now let's see a very simple example of how these ACID properties of transactions work. For example, in our example, we'll take a simple bank transaction. For example, I have $500 in my balance, which I have the account ID of ID1, and I would like to send $100 to my friend's account, which have the ID number 2. So this particular transaction have two operations in it, right? This is a single transaction which have two operations in it. The first operation is to deduct $100 from my balance. The second operation inside the same transaction will be to credit $100 to my friend's account. So I can do this simple bank transaction multiple ways, right? I can use the online application to do it, or I can even use my mobile phone application to do it. In our example, we are using the mobile phone application to do this. Once I begin the transaction on my mobile screen, on my mobile application, SQL Server will also begin the transaction in the background. The first operation will start. It will go ahead and deduct $100 from my balance, which will make $400. The second operation should be to credit $100 to my friend's account. But I suddenly see this on my screen. I am logged out of my mobile phone application, and I see this alert saying facility is temporarily unavailable. Now, wait, what? What has happened? I mean, between the transaction, my transaction is not completed yet. I do not know if I lost my $100 or if my friend has received $100. So I do not know what has happened. So I immediately called her asking if she received any money, which she said she didn't. So I have no other option except to call the bank customer service guys. So when I called them, they said there was a severe thunderstorm and some of their SQL servers went down and they already restarted them. Now just imagine what should happen if this particular transaction is ensuring the ACID properties of transaction. Now let's see what will happen in any of the relational engines if this is the case, like if something happens in between the transaction. Now let's see what will happen once the SQL server restarts. Once the SQL server restarts, the uncommitted transaction will be completely rolled back, reflecting the amount before starting the transaction. So this particular transaction is ensuring ACID properties of transaction. Atomicity is ensured by rolling back the entire transaction. Consistency is ensured by reflecting $500 in my balance, which is the initial amount before starting the transaction. So consistency is ensured. Isolation is also ensured. Like, did you observe, like when SQL Server went and deduct $100 from my account, none of the other transactions were interfering with my transaction. So isolation is also ensured. The durability part is also ensured. I do not lose my money. My $100 is back by reflecting $500 in my balance, which is the initial amount before starting the transaction. So how does this happen, right? Once a server restart, the transaction log made this possible to happen, to roll back the entire transaction. So that's how all the relational engines should satisfy the ACID properties of transactions. Now let's see the overview of memory architecture of SQL Server. The SQL Server Engine is a Windows program which will allocate Windows APIs to allocate memory to the SQL Server. Now, there are different types of components inside the memory architecture of SQL Server. But let's see the major components inside this particular session, the plan cache and the buffer pool, because these are the major components of the memory architecture. Let's see what all other components also we have in the memory architecture of SQL Server. The first one, the plan cache, which is one of the major components. It will hold the store procedures, query plans, etc. The buffer pool, which is the biggest component of the memory architecture. It holds the 8 KB data pages as well as the index pages in it. There are also other type of cache like log cache, token and perm user store cache. Now, what this particular token and perm user store cache does is it will store the user permissions onto the objects. There is also other type of cache known as column store cache, which will store the column store indexes in it. Now, all these caches which you are seeing in the blue color are very special. Now, why I say very special? Because they can be easily expanded as well as shrinked when there is a memory pressure. Now, how can they be expanded and shrinked when there is a memory pressure? They have a backing mechanism in them. Now, what is this backing mechanism? For example, the plan cache, which will hold the store procedures in it, the query text behind that store procedure is stored inside the system tables of the SQL Server. The buffer pool, which holds the 8 KB data pages and index pages, those 8 KB pages are stored inside the disk subsystem as the database files. And the other caches like the log cache, it will be stored as a transaction log inside our disk subsystem. And the column store cache here, the column store indexes are stored inside our column store cache, right? Those column store indexes are compressed and they are also stored inside the disk subsystem. So now these caches which you are seeing in the blue color are very special, because they can be easily expanded and shrinked when there is a memory pressure, just because they have a backing mechanism in them, right? But what about the fixed memory, which you are seeing in the blue color? Fixed memory is known as fixed because it cannot be expanded or shrinked when it is in use. Now, what kind of things will be using this fixed memory? The connections to the SQL Server, like the memory grants that we assign for a query before it executes, those kind of connections are given to the SQL Server, are saved inside this fixed memory. Now, this fixed memory cannot be shrinked or expanded because it doesn't have any backing mechanism in them. That's the reason it's called fixed memory. Now, there is also other type of memory known as SQL Server.exe overhead memory. As you know, the SQL Server.exe is an executable and many things will be running this executable, right? For example, the thread stacks, those kind of things are also come under the memory architecture of SQL Server. And there is also other type of memory known as in-memory OLTP, which will basically stores the memory optimized tables in it. Now, even this type of memory, in-memory OLTP, is fixed memory. It cannot be expanded or shrinked when there is a memory pressure. Like, there should be some other process which should be kicked in, clean up all the existing memory optimized tables in it, such that we'll get more space for the additional new memory optimized tables to be fit in. So that's how the in-memory OLTP works. So this is the overview of memory architecture of SQL Server. Now let's see how the cache get managed inside the SQL Server. Now, how does this memory gets managed? There is something known as least recently used algorithm, which is also known as LRUK algorithm. The hyphen K is for the complexity of the code. So what is this LRU? LRU meaning, if something is staying in the cache for longer time, those kind of things will be discarded first. But what happens with this SQL Server? SQL Server will think this way. If there is an execution plan that is created for a query, very easily and with less amount of cost and resources, those kind of execution plans will be discarded first. But if that execution plan is created with complicated logic and so much of resources are needed to be created that particular execution plan, those kind of execution plans will have chances to stay in the cache for longer time. So there are two types of process which will manage this kind of memory, the lazy writer as well as the ghost cleanup. Now let's see how these lazy writer and ghost cleanup work with plan cache. Now, this is my plan cache, and the right side diagram which you are seeing is my plan cache, which is very, very small. I just have three execution plans in it, the plan one, plan two, and plan three. Now, each and every object inside the plan cache have two different numbers on the bottom of each object. The left side number is known as complexity code value, and the right side number is known as complexity countdown value. Now, what happens is, whenever the lazy writer, this lazy writer component will be kicked in by SQL Server automatically every minute. It does it automatically on the background. Now, what this lazy writer does is, it will go ahead and check if there are any least recently used execution plans. Now, in our example, none of them will be used. So what it does is, in this case, it will go ahead and decrement the complexity countdown value by one on each object it thinks it did not use. Now, in our example, none of them will be used. So what it does is, it will go ahead and decrement the plan one complexity countdown value from 18 to 17, for the plan two from 9 to 8, and for the plan three from 2 to 1. And the lazy writer will go away. In the very next minute, the lazy writer will kick back in again, because it is an automated process, right? It will come and check if there are any least recently used execution plans. In our example, none of them will be used again. So what it does is, it will go ahead and decrement the plan one complexity countdown value from 17 to 16, for the plan two from 8 to 7, and for the plan three from 1 to 0. Now, did you observe? The complexity countdown value for the plan three has changed to 0. That means the SQL Server should go ahead and discard this particular plan out of the cache, right? But that is not what it is going to happen. There is some other process known as ghost cleanup, which will be kicked in automatically by the SQL Server every few minutes. What it does is, it will just go ahead and check if there are any execution plans that do not have any countdown value. Once it finds them, it will flag them as ghosted. That means they are still in the plan cache, but they are in the half-life. For example, there is a memory pressure tomorrow, right, on that particular server. What happens is, as on the regular basis, the ghost cleanup will come, and it will basically clean up all these ghosted execution plans out of the cache. But what if there is no memory pressure? If there is no memory pressure, then SQL Server is still going to keep these execution plans inside the cache, such that tomorrow some other user might come and his query might use the same execution plan. So that's how the ghost cleanup works. And in the very next moment, the lazy writer will kick back in again to see if there are any least recently used execution plans. In our example, plan two will be used now. So what it does is, it will go ahead and increment that particular complexity countdown value to its original value for the plan to 9. So that's how the lazy writer and the ghost cleanup works for the plan cache. Now let's see how the buffer pool works. The buffer pool, basically it is a part of storage engine. It basically stores the 8KB data pages as well as the index pages in it. So basically, buffer pool has to manage three types of different structures in it: the heap tables, which don't have the clustered index on the top of it, that's called heap table, and the clustered indexes and non-clustered indexes. Basically, these three structures the buffer pool should manage. So basically, for example, if you wanted to do a select star from a heap table, which do not have any clustered index on the top of it, you know what will happen? The buffer pool, it should go ahead and grab all those data pages into its memory and do the operations over there, which will take so much of IO resources to do this process, right? Because it have to grab all those pages into the buffer pool. But instead of that, if you put in clustered index and non-clustered indexes on the top of it, then the SQL Server, like buffer pool, has to go only few trips into the disk subsystem to grab those pages into the memory. Now that will be very helpful to reduce the IO as well as speed up the query process. Now, how does this buffer pool gets managed? There is something known as checkpoint process, which will be kicked in every few minutes by the SQL Server automatically. Now, what it does is, it will go ahead and check if there are any dirty pages inside the buffer pool. Now, what are these dirty pages? Dirty pages are the pages which are modified already in the buffer pool, but they are not hardened them onto the disk file system. Basically, they are 8KB pages, which the buffer pool grabs from the disk subsystem. They are modified inside the buffer pool, but they are not hardened to the disk. So what the checkpoint process does is, whenever it kicks in by the SQL Server automatically, it will go ahead and check if there are any dirty pages in this buffer pool and push those dirty pages inside the database file system, such that there will be more space for the new 8KB pages to help the other users to get into the buffer pool and do the operations over there. That's how the buffer pool gets managed by the checkpoint process. Now, this is the very important slide. How the SQL optimizer will choose the plans, right? SQL optimizer is a cost-based optimizer. It always wanted to choose the good enough plan instead of the best plan. Now, what is the difference? The time and the cost is the difference. For example, we have a very simple select statement here with a 4 table joins in it, right? Instead of SQL optimizer choosing the good plan, what if it will go ahead and choose the best plan, what it have to do on the background? Let's see. First, it will go ahead and check 72 different types of physical access method per table, just per table. We just have a 4 table, just simple select statement here, right? But for every table, it have to go ahead and choose 72 different types of physical access methods, like whether it have to do clustered index scan or seek, or whether it have to use the non-clustered index scan or seek, those kind of things, 72 per table. And we have 4 tables here, 72 times 4, very cost consuming, right? And on the top of it, it have to go ahead and choose 24 different types of logical join orders. Now, what are these logical join orders? Meaning, for example, we have a select statement with a 4 table join here, right? The optimizer, if for example, the join between A to B will filter out 50% of the records from the result set, and the join between B to C will filter out 99% of the records from the result set, then the SQL optimizer will go ahead and reorder the join in such a way that it will push the join between B to C front of the statement and rest of the joins back of it. Now, why it do that is because it wanted to grab the results as quickly as possible. On the top of it, it have to go ahead and analyze so many transformation rules that it will grab approximately 26,000 possible plans just for this very simple select statement. Now, just imagine how much cost and IO consuming it is for the optimizer to go ahead and choose a best plan out of these 26,000 possible plans. And no user wanted to wait for such long time to get the results, right? So that's the reason SQL optimizer will go ahead and grab the good enough execution plan as quickly as possible, such that to satisfy that particular query. So that's the reason why the SQL optimizer is so quick and so optimal. Now, I would like to thank Kevin Klein for loaning me this example. If I have to tell you the same concept in very simple words, if the optimizer choose the plan A execution plan in 3 milliseconds and the plan B execution plan in 3.5 milliseconds, but if the optimizer has to go and analyze all these transformation rules on the background for 5 minutes to just choose if the plan A is better or B is better, it doesn't want to do that. It will just go ahead and grab plan A or plan B randomly. That's the reason why the optimizer. Let's see how the lifecycle of a query works. Now, if the lifecycle of a query is divided into 3 different steps, the first step components contain parser, binder, simplification, and the trivial plan. Now, these components from the first step are very easy and very lightweight to the SQL Server. They just need the query as well as the table definitions. That's all they need. But when you come to the second step components contain the load metadata, join heuristics, and search phases. Now, these components requires a lot of metadata to process any query inside the SQL Server. Now, when you come to the third step contains the access methods, transaction manager, and buffer manager. Now, these components from the third step are very IO intensive and resource consuming. Now, why I say that? Because we have a buffer manager here, which will go ahead and grab the data pages from the disk file system, right? Which is very IO intensive. That's the reason I say it's very cost consuming. Now, when you come to the first step as well as the second step components will come under the relational engine, and the third step components will come under the storage engine. Now, let's see how the select query works, right, for the relational engines. Now, we have a user here who wanted to do a select query onto the SQL Server. Now, no matter what kind of interface he's using, he might be using SQL Server, Management Studio, Azure Data Studio, .NET Visual Studio, or even a third-party application like the web application. No matter what kind of application he is using, he should first get the secure network connection to the SQL Server. Now, how does that happen? There is something known as SNI, which is also known as SQL Server Network Interface. Now, what SQL Server Network Interface does is it will use the internet protocol to secure a network connection between the SQL Server as well as the user here. Now, the TCP/IP, the protocols, the internet protocols might be the TCP/IP, the named pipe, shared memory. No matter what kind of internet protocols are used, the process remains the same. So once the secure network connection has been established between the user as well as the SQL Server, then the query that the user is sending is wrapped inside a tabular data stream packet, which is also known as a TDS packet. And that TDS packet will be given to the SQL Server operating system. So once that TDS packet has reached to the SQL operating system, the SQL operating system will identify that coming connection as a SQL connection, and it will assign a SPID to it, the SQL Server process ID. And once the process ID has been assigned, then that TDS packet will be unwrapped by the SQL operating system and identify that query as a SQL query, and then it will give that query to the first step inside the relational engine. That's parser. Now, what does the parser do? Right? The parser just, it will identify the syntactical errors of the query that we are sending to the SQL Server. Now, basically, it will validate the syntax. For example, if you wanted to do a select star from a table, but instead by mistake you have given select star from, then at this particular stage, the parser should identify that as a syntactical error and throw back the error to the user saying it is syntactically incorrect. And the views are expanded here. For example, if you are doing a select star from a view, the code text behind that view will be brought in line into the code we are sending. And the variables are declared here. For example, if you are using any variables, declaring any variables, those variables are validated here at the parser stage. And with all this information, the parser, what it does is it will put a hash on our query, which we are sending, and it will basically compare against the execution plan hash inside our plan cache. If it finds the exact match of the execution plan for that particular query, it will go ahead and send the same execution plan for the execution phase. But if it didn't find any execution plan, what it does? It will go ahead and build an initial logical tree at that particular stage at the parser. And then our query is now sent to the binder component. Now, binder is also known as algebraizer or normalizer. What it does is it will go ahead and validate the objects. Parser will be the one which will just identify the syntax of the query, but binder is the one which will identify and validate the objects which we are using in our query, like tables, columns, whether they are valid or not. And then user permissions are checked here, whether the user that is running the particular query have the permissions to execute those objects or not. Those kind of things are checked here. And data type resolution happens here. For example, if we are doing a select in between the two tables, and we are using a union all clause in between those two tables, then the ordinal columns of those two tables should be matched in the data type. I will show you in the demo example of what that means. And aggregate bindings also happens here, like the sum, average, those kind of things are bound here. With all this information, the parse tree inside the plan cache will be once again updated, and then the query is now sent to the simplification component. Now, the simplification itself says that it will simplify the query, right? For example, we have a subquery in it that we are sending to the server. Then that particular subquery will be simplified into a simple join by this simplification component. That's all it does. And then the contradiction detection also happens here, like whether there is a foreign key relationship contradiction, those kind of things are bound here. Now, with all this information, the parse tree inside the plan cache is once again updated, and our query will now be sent to the trivial plan component. For example, the query which we are sending is very simple, like very simple select star from a table or select star from a table with a simple where clause. The SQL Server will think this way. This is a very simple query, Now, why should I even go ahead and update the parse tree inside the plan cache that the previous component has been built? I will just go ahead and discard that plan cache, discard that plan which has been built inside the plan cache, and I will just go ahead and create a trivial plan on the fly, just like that. Because it doesn't cost it much, it doesn't cost any resources to create a trivial plan. So what it does is it will just go ahead and discard the parse tree that has been built until now. It will just go ahead and create the trivial plan on the fly and use that trivial plan for the execution phase. But what if the query is not so simple that we are sending? We might be sending a complicated query with 10 tables in it, with a complicated logic in it, with order bys, group bys, all of that fancy stuff. Then the SQL server will think, now this query is really complicated. Let me send this particular query to the second step inside the relational engine. And then our query is now at the second step of the relational engine. The first component is the load metadata here. Now load metadata at this particular component, most of the metadata that needs to be processed any query are gathered here. Like for example, the index statistics and histograms. Now what are these index statistics? Index statistics are the blob structures that are created by the SQL server to describe the distribution of the data inside a column of a table or the columns of a table or an indexed view. Those kind of statistics are gathered, and auto-create statistics are also happened here. Now, what are these auto-create statistics? For example, if you are doing a select star from a table with a where clause and you are regularly running a search on that particular where clause, with a column on it, and that column doesn't have any statistics on it, SQL Server will just go ahead and auto-create the statistics such that it will estimate how many rows it can get back out of that particular table during the execution phase of that particular query. Those kind of things are identified here. And cardinality estimates happens here. Cardinality meaning how many number of rows that the SQL Server is thinking that it will come out of a table at each operator inside our execution plan. Those kind of things are gathered here. And SQL Server collation and Windows collation are checked here. And set options are also checked here, like set XML on or off, set ANSI padding on or off. Depending upon those on or off settings, the execution plan might be dependent. And with all this information, the parse tree inside the plan cache is once again updated. And then our query is at the join heuristic component. Now, join heuristic component, the reordering of join that I described in the previous slides, but let me describe that again, once again. For example, we have a three-table join statement, right? For example, if the join between A to B will filter out 60% of the records from the result set, and the join between B to C will filter out 99% of the records from the result set, then the optimizer will go ahead and reorder the join in such a way that it will push the join between B to C front of the statement and rest of the joins back of it. Now, why it do that? Because it wanted to grab the results as quickly as possible. And with all this information, the parse tree inside the plan cache is once again updated, and then our query will go to the search phases component. Now, in the very next slide, I'm going to discuss what these search phases are. But for now, just remember that the SQL optimizer is a cost-based optimizer. It always wanted to choose the good enough plan, quote unquote, good enough plan instead of the best plan. So what it does is it will go ahead and grab the execution plans from these three phases, phase zero, phase one, and phase two. Once it finds the good enough plan from these three phases, it will go ahead and update that plan inside the plan cache and put a hash on it finally. And then our query will now send to the third step of the storage engine. Before going into the third step of the storage engine, let's see what these search phases are. Now, the optimizer, to process any query, it have to go ahead and grab the execution plan from these three phases. The phase zero is also known as a transactional plan. Basically, the plans are created at the pre-optimization stage here. Now, what is this pre-optimization stage, right? The pre-optimization stage is the first step. The parser, binder, simplification, and the trivial plan components which we have seen, those are the pre-optimization stage. That means the trivial plans are created here. Trivial plans are created with less amount of cost and resources. Basically, it doesn't cost the engine much at all. So they are created very quickly, as soon as possible. These execution plans are created for a very small queries, like maximum of 3 tables, and very basic heuristics are needed, like the query definitions and the table definitions. That's all it needs. But when you come to the phase one is known as a very quick plan. Now, these execution plans are created for the queries with maximum of 8 tables in it. More transformation rules are needed than the phase zero. Now, what the optimizer does is it will take our, for the phase zero as well as the phase one, is the optimizer, it will take our query, it will compare our query with already existing execution shapes. Once it finds the good enough execution shape, it will just go ahead and grab the execution plan from that particular execution shapes. But that is not the case with the phase two. Phase two is known as full plan. Now, these execution plans are created for the more complicated queries, like more of the parallelism spills and spool to the TempDB happens here. Almost all of the transformation rules are unlocked here. Now, what the phase two does is the optimizer doesn't take our query and compare with the already existing execution shapes. But instead, what it does is it will go ahead and prune off all the transformation rules that we are not using in our query. Now, what I mean by that is, for example, if we are not using NVARCHAR max or blob data types inside our query, then the SQL engine will go ahead and prune off all these transformation rules which are related to that NVARCHAR max and blob data types, such that it will have more options to just go ahead and analyze only a couple of the transformation rules to get that good enough execution plan as quickly as possible. Now, that's how the optimizer will go ahead and choose the execution plan from these three components, these three phases, basically. Now, our query is at the storage engine component. Now, let's see the read transaction first, right? Now, just remember that any kind of query, it might be the read, write transaction, no matter what kind of query it is, those queries should pass through the first step as well as the second step. If the query is really simple, then the trivial plan gets generated and it will be sent to the execution phase. But if the query is very complicated, then it will be passed through the second stage, right? Second step. But even it is a trivial plan or complicated query, no matter what kind of query it is, it have to touch the storage engine, right? Because it have to grab the results. That means it have to touch the storage engine. But all the difference happens at this phase, transaction manager and the buffer manager components of the storage engine. Now let's see what this access method is. Access methods, it doesn't do the operation by itself, but all it does is it will grab the results from, it will just analyze how it have to grab the results from the disk file system. That's all it does. When the query has gone to the transaction manager component, the transaction manager have two subcomponents in it. One is the log manager and the other is log manager. Now, as this is a read transaction, transaction manager will just invoke the log manager part of it. Now, why only log and not log is because we are not modifying any data, right? This is a read transaction. We are not modifying any data inside the buffer pool for the databases. So that's the reason transaction manager will just invoke the log manager part of it. And it will go ahead and request buffer manager to put a lock on, shared lock on the resources that the buffer manager needs. But why shared lock is because this is just a read transaction. We do not want to block any other queries, right? That's the reason it's a shared lock. Once the query is sent to the buffer manager component, first it will put the shared lock on the resources it needs. And then it will go ahead and check if all the pages that it needs are already in the buffer pool. If it didn't find any, it will go ahead and grab those pages from the database file system, from the disk file system, grab them inside the buffer pool in the form of the 8KB pages, do the operation over there, and then send the results to the user. Read transaction, very simple. But what happens with the write transaction, right? Write transaction is a little bit different. Let's see. The access methods, as I said, like this just will analyze how it have to grab the results from the disk file system. But once the query has now sent to the transaction manager component, now the transaction log manager part of it will be invoked first. There are two components, right? The log manager and the log manager. First, the log manager will be invoked. Now, why? Because this is a write transaction and we are going to modify the database pages inside the buffer pool. Now, before writing anything into the database files inside the buffer pool or modifying any pages inside the buffer pool, first the transaction manager will go ahead and write that particular modifications into the transaction log. Now, why you do that? Because as we discussed in the ACID properties, right? If something happens in between the transaction, once we restart the SQL server, the transaction log will help rolling back the entire transaction to its original value. That's the reason it will go ahead and write everything, what is the initial value, what they are going to change, and all these kind of information inside the transaction log. And then it will, once it have written, then it will go ahead and request the buffer manager to put an exclusive lock on the resources it needs. Now, why exclusive? Because we do not want any other transaction to be interfering with my transaction. Again, the ACID properties of transaction, right? The isolation component works here. So once the query has now reached to the buffer manager will first put the exclusive lock on the resources it needs to be process this query, and it will go ahead and check if there are any data pages that it needs are already in the buffer pool. If it didn't find any, it will go ahead and grab those pages in the form of 8 KB pages, put them in the memory, do the modification over there, and send the success message to the user. But did you observe the data pages has already been modified in the buffer pool, but they are not hardened them onto the disk? That's when the checkpoint process will be kicked in. It will go ahead and push these dirty pages and then put them on back to the database file system and harden them onto the disk. That's how the write transaction works. Now let's see how these pre-optimization stages, the parser, binder, simplification, and the trivial plan works behind the scenes when we submit a query, right? Let's submit a query inside our Management Studio. Management Studio is a tool that we use for the SQL Server to process the queries that we use. So let's see how these queries works behind the scenes. Eric, can you please confirm that you are able to see my screen, the Management Studio? Eric, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still there. I typed in the chat.
Oh, I did not see. So you are able to see, right? Thank you. So for my demo, I'm using the AdventureWorks 2016 database. You can get this from the link over there. Let me put the database in the context. And let me turn on the sparse only option on. When I turn this sparse only option on, what it does is it will just parse the query. But it doesn't generate any execution plan, or it doesn't execute the results, right? We cannot see the results. It will just parse the query. Now let me do a very simple select statement for a table, and there are no syntactical errors in this particular query. Now when I execute this, it should say command completed successfully. But here I wanted to create a manual error here. I'm not declaring the variable, but I'm using the variable inside the where clause. Now when I run this, the parser should identify that as a syntactical error, saying must declare the scalar variable. So that's how the parser works. Now let me do a select non-existing column from a non-existing table and see if the parser will identify this as a issue. Now it won't, because the parser will just identify the syntax, but binder is the one which will identify and validate the objects inside our tables as well as the columns, right? So let me turn off this parse only option off. Let me turn on the format only option on. Now what this format only option on does is it will just invoke the parser as well as the binder components in it. That's all it does. It doesn't execute the results, or it doesn't generate the execution plan. Now this is a very simple select statement, and we wanted to just check and validate the objects. So now when I execute this, it doesn't produce any results, as I said. it didn't throw any error because all the objects are validated properly. But here I wanted to execute the same statement again, but this time the binder should kick in, right? It should throw me an error. Like it validated the object saying invalid object. Let me turn off this format only option off. And let's see the data type resolution that I discussed before, right? This is a very simple select statement between the two tables, and we are using a union clause in between those two tables. The ordinal columns should be matched of their data type, right? The customer ID is of an integer data type, and the sales order ID is of an integer data type too. So when I execute this query, it should not throw me any error. It should produce the results. But if I go ahead and manually create an error saying customer ID is of an integer data type here, but this credit card approval code is of varchar data type here. Now, when I execute this, it should throw me an error saying the conversion failed for converting the varchar value to the data type integer, right? So that's how the parser and binder works. Now let's see how the simplification works. Let me put the database in the context again. And then simplification will actually simplify the query by converting the subqueries into a simple join, right? So let me run this. This is in this query, we have a simple subquery in it, right? Let me turn on this execution plan. Now I'm going to show you the execution plan, like how does it convert into a simple join and then execute the query. And when you go to the execution plan, this is the execution plan of that particular query. And when you check here, it says a simple inner join, right? It just converted to an inner join. So no matter if you submit any subqueries to the server, it will automatically on the background will convert into a simple join. Now simplification will also remove the redundant joins. Now, for example, here in this select statement, I am only grabbing the results from sales order header table, but I'm not getting any results from the customer table, right? I'm not at all using the customer table, but simply we are using that customer table in the query just uselessly. So SQL Server on the background, it should go ahead and remove that redundant joins. Now we can see that inside our execution plan once again. When you go to the execution plan, now did you observe it just showed the sales order header table, but it did not show the customer table. That means it did not even touch the customer table. It just removed that redundant table out of the query on the background. Now let's see how the contradiction works here. I manually created the contradiction saying where territory ID is equal to 1 and where territory ID is not equal to 1. Now, when I execute this particular query, it should not throw me an error, but also it doesn't show me any results. Now, why it did not throw me an error? Because this is a pre-optimization stage, right? SQL Server doesn't know what those values are that you are using in the where clause. It can be territory ID is equal to 1 or territory ID is equal to 10,000. It doesn't know at the pre-optimization stage. And now let me show you, this is a very simple select query. Now let's see if this particular query will create the trivial plan, because as we discussed, SQL Server should, if the query is very simple, it should go ahead and create the trivial plan, right? We can see that in the execution plan. So when you go to the execution plan, right click, go to the properties in the execution plan. Here, the optimization level of that particular query shows as trivial. That means the SQL optimizer thought this particular query very simple, and it thought, let me create the trivial plan on the fly, and I don't want to save these trivial plans inside our plan cache because it doesn't want to save these trivial plans inside the plan cache because it wanted to save those particular memory inside the plan cache for the more complicated queries. Now, if you wanted to convert that trivial plan into a full plan, full optimization plan, then you can do that manually by turning on the trains flag 8757 onto that particular query. Now, when you use this trace flag on in that particular query, it doesn't affect the server or it doesn't affect any other databases. It is only bound to that particular query. Now, when I execute this particular query and go to the execution plan, do a select, uh, do a go to the properties and check for the optimization level. Now it has converted that to the full plan. That means this plan is now saved inside our plan cache. I do not suggest to do this on the production, but there are always caveats, right? There are always cases where sometimes SQL Server will go ahead and create the trivial plans when you thought it will create a full plan. Now, when you wanted to convert that into a full plan, you will want to go ahead and turn on this trace flag 8757 for that particular query. Now, let me hop back into my slides again. That's how the pre-optimization stages work. Now, what have we seen in this particular session today? We have gone through the overview of ACID properties of transaction with a simple example ensuring the ACID properties. Now, all these ACID properties should be ensured for every single relational systems, for every single relational engines. It might be MariaDB, it might be MySQL. All these relational engines should definitely satisfy the ACID properties of transactions. And we have seen the overview of memory architecture of SQL Server, what all components we have in the memory architecture of SQL Server. In this particular session, we have seen the major components, how these caches get managed inside the SQL engine for the plan cache and the buffer pool. And also we have seen the life cycle of a query for the read as well as the write transaction, like what happens behind the scenes at each component inside the SQL Server when we submit any query. We have also seen the different types of components we have in the SQL engine, that's the relational engine as well as the storage engine. And for preparing my presentation, I have used several wonderful resources. Please go ahead and look into these resources if you want to know more about these relational engines and how these works behind the scenes. And I would like to thank each and every one of the attendee for attending this session. I hope you liked it. And I would like to finally thank you so much, Eric Mulder, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to speak for the Drupal Jam conference for the first time. Thank you so much once again. And if you have any questions, please, this is the time to shoot at me back. Thank you so much.
So Diti, yeah, thank you very much for presenting. As you said in the start of your presentation, let me just check because I have a terrible echo. Let's see if this is better. Yeah. I'm in awe with your the technical depth of your knowledge about the SQL engine. And as you said in the start of your presentation, that this is not only for SQL Server, but also MySQL, MariaDB, and those last two are the engines that we tend to use more when working with Drupal. But it's actually also related to all relational database servers. So I think this is a great presentation to better understand what happens under the hood. People that are still with us, shoot if you have any questions. I haven't seen any in the chat. Still a bit silent. So this session is recorded. We will add it to our Drupal Jam website.
Awesome.
People coming back later, there's still an opportunity for them to watch it.
Definitely.
If they want more information, as you said, you're on Twitter as well, DBN yes. Nuggets.
Yes.
Great. Thank you very much for presenting at Drupal Jam Reboot. And in this way, online, perhaps next time when all the coronavirus is behind us, we can invite you to the Netherlands and do a live presentation at our event.
Thank you so much, Eric. It's an honor. It's really an honor to be presenting for Drupal Jam. Hopefully, I will see you for the next conferences for DrupalDem too. And if you wanted to get the slides and demo deck, and I have my GitHub repository, I can share the link. I can email you, and you can put that thing at the recording page.
Okay, perfect. We will do that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you again, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.